Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have gone to and fro from Jannah to Jahannam to try and make shafa'a, and he will make intercession, and people will get out of, you know, I said this in the last talk, people will come out of Jahannam until finally the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will go into heaven, he will go into paradise. When he goes into Jannah, after a long while Allah will call Jibreel alayhi salam. Oh Jibreel, go down and see inside Jahannam, is there anyone left from the believers, someone who had some belief in me, is there anyone left? So Jibreel alayhi salam comes down and he finds someone. This person, la ilaha illallah. You know when you fry chips? And you're frying chips and you know frying in a pan and you're frying it or some samosa, whatever it is, okay? One part has broken off and that part fries on top of the oil. And every time you take the new chips out, put more chips inside, there's that one piece that is floating, sizzling at the top, is black, it's burnt all over. You know what I'm talking about? Well, that's this guy in Jahannam. Completely burnt out, completely black, everything's been burnt off, and he's sizzling on top of Jahannam. And he's saying what? And these words that he's using, they're the most beloved words to me. And you know, when I say these words, one thing we have to do, brothers, we have to imagine this guy could be me. You know, this guy could be me, la ilaha illallah. You know, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he said, I have so much fear in Allah. So much fear. If on the day of judgment, Allah, this is the man whom Rasulullah said, you're in Jannah. He said, I have so much fear in Allah, so much fear that on the day of judgment, if Allah said all people go to Jannah except for one man who I'm going to throw into hellfire, I've got so much fear that I believe I could be that person. Subhanallah. And Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab said in the same statement, he said, I have so much hope in Allah, so much hope that if on the day of judgment Allah said all people go to Jahannam except for one man, I believe I could be that one man. La ilaha illallah. So you know, when you read this hadith and you hear his words, I want you to do one thing that I do, which is say these words and imagine you're this man. Imagine you're this man. You're the last person. We're not saying that we're going to become this man by doing this, okay? Don't get worried, guys. It's a way of making yourself feel very humble in front of Allah. Because if you don't believe you could become the worst person in the next life, then you're going to do whatever you want. So what's his words? Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan. Hannan, Ya Mannan. Our Allah who turns to his servant after his servant turns to him. Our Allah who turns to his servant before his servant turns to him. Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan. Say it, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan. So these are the two names of Allah that he's saying. Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan is burning. Jibreel comes straight to Allah and says, oh Allah, there is one person. Allah knows he's there. But he wants to show us his mercy. So he says, yes. And what does he want? Go and ask him, what does he want? So Jibreel says, Allah sent me to you, ask you, what do you want? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now talking to this person directly. He says, oh Allah, all I want, just take me out of this place. I can't ask you anything more. Hannan, Mannan, they say me out of this place. Allah says, if I take you out of this place and you start asking me one more thing, no, Allah. I just want to get out of this place and that's it. Allah says, okay, take him out. So Allah takes him out. Allah tells Jibreel to wash him, or the angels to wash him. He gets washed. Now this water that is called Ma'ul Hayat. Anyone who went to Jahannam as a Muslim or as a good Christian in the time of, you know, after Isa alayhi salam and after Musa, the good Jews, They will be washed. If they end up in hellfire, they will be washed. This is not talking about the Christians and Jews in our time. They have to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, they have to believe to get to Jannah. Now they have to believe in that. I'm talking about the people, the Christians, Jews before, and the Muslims or anyone who believed in the Prophet of their time, when the Prophet was around before the next Prophet came, and they ended up in Jahannam. Allah would say, okay, now wash them with ma'ul hayat. It's a fresh water that washes all the things from the body, except one thing. There's a mark that stays here. The mark that stays here is freed from hell, out of the mercy of God. Freed from hell, out of the mercy of God. So that's, and when they go to Jannah, you know what happens? The people who are in Jannah, they look at them and they think, oh, hey, that's a guy that's been freed from, that's a guy that's been freed from hellfire. Look at his forehead. And they will make dua to Allah, oh Allah, please. All these people are looking at that. So Allah will say, okay, now he will then wipe that off their heads. So they will be like the rest of them, okay? Now this guy's got this mark on his head, but he's nice and, you know, healthy as anything. So then, you know, he's middle of nowhere. No man's land. He's out of Jahannam, but not in Jannah. In the distance, he can see a beautiful place. Man, so beautiful. What did Rasulullah say about Jannah? مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. No man has, no man's ears, no woman's ears has heard of Jannah. No eyes have ever seen Jannah. No mind has thought of Jannah. You know, you can sit here and Allah has said in the Quran, He said, I'll give you grapes in Jannah. Yes? What has Allah said He's going to give us? Grapes. You can take the best grapes you want in this world and say, is it going to be like this? No, 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 no. If you think that they're going to be like these grapes, you've lost it. This is nothing. This is nothing. You cannot imagine Jannah. Imam Ghazali said what? Imam Ghazali said a wonderful thing. He said, if you want to understand Jannah, the happiness of Jannah, I'm going to say this, yeah, but hope it's not going to be too offensive for some of you to say that, to hear this, yeah? Get ready, guys, yeah? Imam Ghazali says in his book, he says, when a man is sleeping with a woman and then doing the business, you know the business? You know the business? They're doing the business. Some guy says, yes. The rest of you stay quiet. Don't worry, don't worry. When he gets to his peak, and his eyes are rolling, or her eyes are rolling, and they feel a great happiness inside them. He said that happiness, Imam Ghazali says, that happiness when they're in that mode, that's possibly the lowest, 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 lowest thing ever anyone can imagine, the happiness of Jannah. Because the people of Jannah will always have a happiness beyond that. Can you imagine? They're always inside Jannah beyond that. Don't worry, they're not going to be walking like this. Allah will give them the heart to take all of that, right? In fact, in the hadith, he says, subhanAllah, he says, Rasulullah has said, he said, every man will be given the power of 100 men of this earth in three things: eat, drink, and sleep with the opposite gender. You got a power of 100 men. So don't worry, you don't need to take Viagra with you on the other side. Right? People who are in this, all this, I don't know what they do, try to get some pleasure in this world, you don't have to take any of that. Yeah, there's plenty of things without any of these prescriptions over there. So this man here is looking at Jannah, and he hears, he must be hearing the, you know, Jannah is going to be buzzing. Buzzing with the beautiful sounds that are coming from it. There's a lot of music in Jannah, but don't make music halal here. Alright? Because you just think it's in Jannah. So he then thinks, subhanAllah, he thinks, what am I doing here? He says, Ya Hanan, Ya Manan, Ya Hanan, Ya Manan, Ya Hanan, Ya Manan, Ya Hanan, Ya Manan. Allah says, hey, didn't you just tell me that you're not going to ask me anything more? please Allah, my last wish. What's your last wish? Oh Allah, please take me close to that place, right in the distance, I can see it, I can hear, please just take me close to there. Allah says, okay, here, go close. Are you going to ask me again? No, Allah, I'm not going to ask you again. Takes me close there. He comes near Jannah, and now he's outside Jannah, he's looking through the glass. You can imagine what he's seeing. Oh my God. He's seeing people are in bliss. can you imagine what Jannah is? There's people flying in the air, brothers. Yeah? It's not a normal place here. There's people who are living underwater. And they're with their wives as well. You know what I'm saying? Like, and the people in their palaces, and they're still on their 70th plate. And there's probably, you know, another few, there's another 70 rooms, and each room has got 70 plates, and each room has got another 70 beds as well, with 70 women waiting on site. So when he's seeing all this going on, whatever he's seeing, I'm not saying this hadith says what he says, but I'm saying from different hadith, he must be seeing a lot of stuff. And when he sees all of that, he says, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan. And I say, hey! You just said you're not going to ask him. Please, 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 please. One more, lick one. So I said, okay, what do you want? He said, just please put me inside. Just inside, please. I'll go inside. Will you ask me again? No. I said, last one. So Allah then puts him inside. Now he goes inside. And you know what's happening, right? The guy doesn't own a penny in Jannah. He doesn't own anything in Jannah. So now he's in Jannah, and obviously people are seeing the mark. And he's the last guy to have that mark. And can you imagine if somebody comes up to him and says, Hey, man, you know, where did he live? Where did he come from? He's going to say, somewhere. So he's now feeling guilty. He ain't got a place in Jannah, he ain't got nothing, no land in Jannah, no palace in Jannah, no plot in Jannah, no woman in Jannah. So he says, Ya Allah, Ya Hannan, Ya Mannan, Ya Hannan. Hey! Didn't you just say that? Okay, now he's thinking, oh my God, I've been taking the mic. Right? I better, when I make my wish this time, I said, what do you want? He said, when I make my wish this time, I better get it right. Okay? Because I can't carry on doing this, right? So he thinks, Allah said, what do you want now? So he thinks, okay, yeah. He's probably thinking about Forest Gate, thinking probably about North London, you know, one of us are from, yeah? So he's thinking, he goes, no. That place, Forest Gate, was too small, man. North London too small, London's too small, England's too small, Europe's too small, America, the whole world. Okay. Allah, I've got it right, okay. You give me Allah, you know the world I was living in, the world, planet Earth, where I came from. I want a place in Jannah, whole of the place to me, myself, and more. The whole of that same as planet Earth, whole of it. America, Australia, the whole of the oceans, everything, the size of the whole planet. I want it for myself. Allah will say what, Subhan? Allah will say, oh my servant, here it is, and he gives him. And here's double that, gives him. Here's triple that, gives him. Here's quadruple of that, gives him. Here's another one, gives him. And take it again, and take it again, and take it again, take it again, and take it again, and take it again, 10 times. And he said, what all this? He said, take it. And then he fills it up with all the things he needs inside it. Out of the mercy of the Rahman. Gives it free to him. And that the Rasulullah said, what? That's the man that will receive the minimum amount anyone has received in Jannah. So he said, well, 10 times bigger than this, and with everything filled inside it. Subhanallah, that's the minimum. So anyone else come before him will get 12 times bigger than this, 20 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times. You can't imagine. Jannah is a place where Allah has kept many doors. There are many doors, and there are many stages. Each one is on top of the other. There are 8 Jannahs, or 8 doors to Jannah, and 7 doors to Jahannam. Which gives us another story. Allah's mercy is more than Allah's wrath. So if you think that, you know, if you're fearful, it's a good thing to be fearful of Allah. But don't lose your hope. Don't lose your hope. Now in Jannah, the best part, when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told us, he said the best part of Jannah is the top part, which is Firdaus. Was it? What is it? Firdaus. What did Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said? Subhanallah. Do you want to go to Firdaus, brothers? Do you want to go to Firdaus?
Yes.
You're serious?
Yes.
There's a couple of ways to get to Firdaus. They're really quick and short. But you guys don't want to know, do you? Do you want to know?
Yes.
Do you guys want to know?
Yes.
Okay. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Hadith of Bukhari, You know Firdaus is? Firdaus is the best part. These are where Allah's arsh is over Firdaus. Allah's throne is straight over there. And from there the four rivers of Jannah. Ma'un, the river of water for the whole of Jannah. That it never is distasteful. And the river of pure milk, the river of pure milk never goes off. The river of honey, asalin, right, which is pure honey. And khamrin, the river of wine, from the Rahman, from Allah's giving you wine. Those four come straight down Allah's arsh, straight into Firdaus, and then they go to the other places. So the first people to receive it are the people of Firdaus. And in Firdaus, you know, people like, you know, if I asked you where would you like to live, some people probably say, yeah, I want to live next to, you know, that star that plays for Man United. That guy that plays for Chelsea, that guy that plays for Tottenham. In this world, they'll say those things. I want to live next to a celebrity. I want to live next to him, yeah? You know the celebrities in Jannah? They are who? They are the prophets. They've got the biggest places. The biggest places in Jannah is the celebrities. And these are the prophets. Next to them is the shuhada, martyrs. Next to them, the siddiqeen, the truthful ones. Sorry, prophets, then siddiqeen, the truthful ones, absolute truthful ones, then the shuhada, the martyrs, then the salihin, the righteous ones. And from amongst the prophets, it will be their companions that will be more or less next to them. But me and you can get right into, you can have a place next to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Talha, and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's place is up there. How? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ana wa kafilul yateemi hataini fil jannah. Rasulullah took his two fingers and he said, me and the one who looks after an orphan are like this in Jannah. If you look after an orphan, if you know an orphan somewhere in the world, and you just completely look after him until he becomes big, and look after him until he gets married or is settled, just do that. And you will be next to Rasulullah in Jannah. Another way, if you haven't got the money or whatever to do that, then, and the most beautiful way is, even better than this, is to be in Jannah next to the Prophet, to be next to the Prophet from the moment you get up, your head comes up from the grave, and you're next to him all the way till you come go straight into Jannah. Isn't that better, guys?
Yes.
Isn't that much better? Would you want that?
Yes.
Come on, guys, do you want that?
Yes.
Subhanallah al-Azim. Prophet ﷺ has said, Inna min ahadikum. He says, the one out of you who is the closest to me on the day of judgment. The closest to me on the day of judgment. And the next to me in Jannah as well is what? Those people who are ahsanuhum akhlaqa, the best of character. You have the best of morals, the best of character, you will be the closest to me on the day of judgment. And this means with him all the way till you get to Jannah. Subhanallah al-Azim. If you want that, if anyone wants that, then these are easy ways to get straight to Jannah. Now from that, the Firdaus comes the rest of Jannah is provided. And underneath each of the Jannahs, there are many different Jannahs. Each garden has a garden above it. Another garden has another garden above it. And they're in so many different ways in so many different places. And you know one beautiful thing is, when you get to Jannah, if you think that subhanAllah, you know, my brother, he ended up in Jannatul Adn, I ended up in Jannatul Ma'wa, and my sister ended up in Jannatul Firdaus, you know, shame. Don't worry, guys, you won't regret. Whatever Allah gives us in Jannah, let's imagine I end up in one place, you end up in one place. You're not going to be looking at me and saying, I'm lower than him in Jannah. I want to find one night to go and steal something from his Jannah. Right? There's not going to be none of that in Jannah. Allah will remove ghil. In the Quran, Allah says, ghil is what? Ghil is this thing inside you that you want to have more. But the only thing Rasulullah has said is, there's going to be one regret, and that one regret is at the door of Jannah. Everyone will have this regret, and that regret is, the person will say, if only I did one more moment of the dhikr of Allah. And they will regret all the moments in their lives that they were out of the dhikr of Allah. All the moments, every single moment in their life. What are you doing right now? What are you doing right now? Are you seriously doing it? Move your tongue. Move your tongue. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Move it. Come on. La ilaha. Don't open your mouths. Look. La ilaha illallah, Allah has made so wonderful because it's the one that has the most ikhlas. Close your lips and say La ilaha illallah. You need to move your tongue. Do you need to move your tongue, yes or no? Yes. Do you need to move your lips? No. Tongue, yes. Lips, no. What are people looking at from the outside? Your tongue or your lips?
Lips.
That's your ikhlas. You close your lips. Inside your mouth, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Oh, subhanallah. Subhanallah, you have to move the lips. Alhamdulillah, you have to move the lips. Allahu Akbar, you have to move the lips. Yep. Astaghfirullah, you move the lips. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have to move the lips. Quran reading, you have to move the lips. La ilaha illallah, do you have to move the lips? No. That's one thing. Now, I hope with your mouth closed, you're doing this. And I hope, inshallah, when you go out, you're still doing it. Because la ilaha illallah will gain a lot in Jannah. Subhanallah, Sayyidina Ibrahim saw our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah on night of Mi'raj. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visited Jannah. And when he visited Jannah, subhanallah, just before I say about Sayyidina Ibrahim, one other thing has come to my mind. When Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visited Jannah, he came back to the earth. And according to a hadith of Bukhari, he said to Sayyidina Bilal, he said, "Oh Bilal, bima sabaqtani ila al-Jannah. Oh Bilal, how did you get to Jannah before me? Oh Bilal, how did you get to Jannah before me?" And this is amongst his companions the next morning when he's the last night he's gone to Jannah and come back. And Sayyidina Bilal, you know, they looked at him. You say, "Who's Sayyidina Bilal? Who's Sayyidina Bilal? He's the most poorest individual, slave, got beaten up. You know, he was on the earth, got nothing." What did he say? He said, Rasulullah said, "Tell me, O Bilal, what is the deed that you've done because of which you've gone into Jannah before me? Because I went to Mi'raj last night, and when I got to Jannah, I heard your footsteps in Jannah. Every time you walked on the earth, you could be heard inside Jannah. And I said to the angels, 'What is it?' They said, 'These are the footsteps of Bilal.' O Bilal, how did you get there?" And Bilal radiallahu anhu said, "What?" He said, "Messenger of Allah, when I was a slave, I never used to have water. It was very difficult for me to get water. And now that I'm a Muslim and I do wudu and I can do wudu with water, I do a special 2 rakats to Allah for this water Allah has given me. And because of that, his extra deed that he did, he goes to Jannah." Was this a deed that the Sahaba were all doing before Bilal? Tell me, yes or no? According to some people, Bilal did bid'ah. Bid'ah. He didn't hear the Prophet tell him to do that, did he? He didn't find in the Quran, did he? But he just did it. Was this bid'ah? Was it bid'ah? No. Okay. Just remember that, guys. Remember that. It's like basically the person who used to recite Qul Huwallahu Ahad at the end of every single prayer. He used to lead the prayers and he used to finish off with Qul Huwallahu Ahad. And they came and they said, "Messenger of Allah," they said, "this person," they complained. They said, "he always finishes the last rak'ah with Qul Huwallahu Ahad every time." Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't reprimand. He said, "Why did you do it?" He says, "I like Qul Huwallahu Ahad." He said, "Okay, carry on doing it." He never found a sunnah to do it. He just felt like doing it, he did it. So it's not that every single action that you do becomes bid'ah if you just do it, alright? You know what I'm saying, guys? I don't want to get into the whole discussion right now. Please don't take this out of context. But anyway, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. And he says, "Akhbir ummataka minni salam. Akhri ala ummatika minni salam." He said, "Say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh to your ummah on my behalf." What do we say? Wa'alaika wa alayhim salam. Wa'alaika wa alayhi salam. To me, to whoever, you know, you say salam. And to who? To Ibrahim, you say wa'alayhi salam. To upon him, may Allah's peace be upon him. And he said, "Tell your ummah that they've got Jannah, but Jannah is empty. And every time they will say subhanallah, they will be making their place in Jannah be better. They will get trees, they will get houses, they will get this and that. So say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. This is creating a Jannah. Every time you say that, it's creating Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, one subhanallah will get you one tree in Jannah. Subhanallah, subhanallah. That's another tree in Jannah. And you know, each tree, you think, what, one tree, two trees, my God. Jannah's big, man. I got to fill that place up, man. How long is it going to take me?" Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us in a hadith of Bukhari that if you get the fastest horseman to go across just the tree trunk of that tree in Jannah, according to one narration, it will take him 100 years. Another narration, it will take him 500 years just to cross the width of that tree. And the roots of it is made of dhahab, is made of gold. The fruits are always hanging down. They're always hanging down. daniya, qutufuha daniya. And when you come into Jannah, the angels are the ones who greet you. You know, when you come to the hotel in this place, you get the serviceman, he's greeting you. Yeah, your serviceman, first serviceman inside Jannah are the angels. And they say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. To you and to all your family members. All of you. Don't worry, they won't have this American accent. Yeah, just put that on. But what they will have is they will have the language of Arabic. Everyone in Jannah will automatically speak Arabic. Everyone in Jannah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, automatically in Jannah, when you get inside, the hadith of Bukhari, you will be like your father Adam alayhi salam, 60 foot tall. 60 foot tall, 7 foot wide. Plenty of enjoyment, brother. Plenty of enjoyment. If you're not big, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like. So they're big. But don't worry, she's going to be big as well. You know what I'm saying? Like, she's not going to be Michi. Everyone will be the size of Adam alayhi salam. Everyone will have the voice of Dawood alayhi salam. Because when Dawood alayhi salam used to sing the Psalms that Allah revealed to him, he used to sing it. And he had the most beautiful voice any human being ever had. And Allah said in the Holy Quran, in Surah Sad, that when he used to sing, At-tayra mahshura, the birds used to come in their hundreds, in lines, in rows, and they used to sit right around him, and they used to all sing along with him. Even Allah said, Al-jibal, the mountains would sing with him. If you heard his voice, your heart would melt. You know, some people have voices, subhanAllah, Allah, they hear the best of the voice. So every person of Jannah will have that voice. Every person in Jannah will get the beauty of Yusuf alayhi salam. Subhanallah. But don't worry, there won't be any other kind of people in Jannah. Only men to women and women to men, alright? There's no other business, alright? You know what I'm saying? Like, anyone thinks that they can go over there and do that kind of thing, you know? Yeah. I'm sorry, that doesn't exist there. Sorry, my friend. Yusuf alayhi salam was the most handsome individual. The women cut their hands, they were blood pouring down. Even if you cut your hand, you know how painful it is. They cut it right from between the thumb and the forefinger. They cut it. Because they cut the apple, they went straight through their skin, into the meat, right towards the bone, and they're still going. That's you in Jannah, brother. When you walk in, the women are going to go. That's it. And sisters. My sister, I'll get to you later on, inshallah. Who are listening. I've got a whole group of men here who have been waiting very long for this talk of Jannah, so I've got to feed them a bit. So you come inside and the angels greet you and you get this, the husn of Yusuf, and from your heart all that hatred is taken out. And the fourth thing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said every person gets what? Is what? You get the character of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah. So you're not going to hurt anyone in Jannah, don't worry. If you basically, accidentally do something, there's no accidents in Jannah, but I'm just saying, if there is, don't worry, there's no hospitals. So if you work as a doctor, you don't get no job in Jannah, don't worry. You know what I'm saying? There's no lawyers in Jannah, there's no arguments in Jannah. So if you're a lawyer, solicitor, nothing. No engineers, you don't have to build Jannah, it's all built for you, right? Nothing goes wrong in Jannah. SubhanAllah, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in the Sahih Hadith of Muslim, you do not even have anything coming out of your nose in Jannah. You know, you get a cold and nothing. You know when you wake up in the morning, you got basically blow your nose out clean. None of that. There's no bad air in Jannah. There's no bad dust in Jannah. Jannah is perfect. The Surah Al-Dahr says that it never لا يرون فيها شمسا ولا زمهريرا. You will never see the sun in Jannah. There's been natural light. You'll never have a cold day in Jannah. There's no cold, there's no hot. You know when sometimes you feel that, on some days you come out and you feel, wow, that is nice, man. The wind is blowing just the right amount. And the sun is, on your face, just the right amount. You know that kind of day? That's every day in Jannah. Every day in Jannah. It never gets, and it gets better, it always gets better. So you can imagine, you've come inside here, there's nothing, no one will spit in Jannah. You know, some guys, I can't stand them in this world when they every time they're, yeah, bro, we're talking about. They think it's Mr. Badman, you know. It's horrible. What are you doing that for? I mean, come on, in the Sunnah, Rasulullah said what? He said, even in masjid, if you see someone's, you know, something come out of their mouth, or the nose, you've seen, you better clean it, because, subhanAllah, what did Prophet ﷺ say? He said, Allah has, this is a hadith in Bukhari, he said, Allah presented to me the actions that, the best of actions and the worst of actions. From the best of actions I saw, a man who will remove a harmful item from the pathway. That's the best of actions. From the worst of actions is, there's a bit of phlegm or there's a bit of the part from the nose, okay, mucus, inside the masjid, and people see it and they don't want to clean it. That's from the worst of actions. So no one's gonna spit in Jannah. No one, there's no toilets in Jannah. Woohoo! You can go, you can enjoy yourself, don't have to worry about the toilet. You can drink, you know, when they drink alcohol, there's a problem of letting it all out, right? There's none of that problem. You can drink and drink. No one will go to the toilet in Jannah, and no one, and then that worried the Sahaba. The Sahaba said, Messenger of Allah, what? Yeah, you drink, you eat all of that, you know, you got the power of 100 men to eat. You know what I'm saying? Now some people, you sit with them in this world, you think, you know, God, take it easy, man. You know, before you got 5 chickens, before you take one in, he's taking 4. Right? God, man, take it easy. Now there's some people like that. Now don't worry, in Jannah, you got plenty of food. Yeah, you know the food in Jannah is so much. La ilaha, so much. You can sit there all day and eat. You can eat. Now you got the word, the Sahaba, they're worried. What's going to happen? So Prophet said, don't worry, you just sweat. Sweat. But what the sweat is, Rasulullah said, your sweat will smell of musk. So when you sweat, it's really nice because you got nice new perfume on yourself. So she's even dying to come closer to you because you sweat. You sweat inside Jannah. In Jannah, you have your labinatun min dhahab, labinatun min fiddah. You have certain houses made of pure gold. There are certain places of Jannah made of pure gold. Certain places made of pure silver. Certain places pure diamonds, pure rubies. And certain places Allah mixes them up. One brick is gold, one brick silver, one brick emerald, one brick diamond, one brick sapphire, one brick something else. Each one is different. The door of one of the, I'm telling you from various hadith now, okay, the door of one of the palaces that you've got in Jannah is so big, it's from the earth here to our sky. And you walk inside. When you walk inside, you've got one room that leads to another room, that leads to another room, that leads to another room, and each one, you can imagine the size of these. Each room has got 70 tables of food. Each table has got 70 different plates of food. Each plate has got certain dishes, and each time they take a fruit, you know what will happen? They take a fruit, and you know, sometimes you get to be spoiled, right? People of Jannah, they get to be spoiled. They eat one fruit and they say, okay, thanks, I've tasted it. They give him a fruit and it looks exactly the same. They say, hey, to the servant. You can have loads of servants. Really nice looking, good young servants, all right? But you can't do anything with them, you know what I'm saying? Yes, to those people, all right? You got... They will serve you. Allah said, Ghilman, the young boys that will serve you. Right? And they will serve you and they will give you dish after dish. The one giving you one, then the next one gives you another one. They're your servants in Jannah. You tell them whatever to do, they'll do it. And they give you one fruit that is similar to another fruit. وَأُتُوبِهِ مُتَشَابِهَا They're given the same fruit. And say, hey, listen, what are you giving the same fruit? I've just tasted this one, give me another one. I say, no, taste it. When they taste it, the same fruit tasted different. The same fruit tastes different. And some fruits, you taste them, each bite you taste, they're always different. Each bite you have is different. So you eat. Allah says what? لَحْمِ طَيْرٍ مِمَّا يَشْتَهُونَ In a hadith of Tirmidhi, a person sees in Jannah, he's sitting down, he's lying down, and he sees a nice bird flying over. It's a real bird, right? Not that other bird, right? The real bird. Flying over. So he sees and he wishes that he could have, you know, he remembers in the world he used to love chicken and chips, right? You know, chicken and chips? I'm not saying the hadith says chicken and chips, right? But I'm just saying, like, he probably wants that roasted right in front of him, grilled, barbecued, whatever. Yeah. So he wants that. He just has his desire, and that bird from the air drops right in front of him, roasted, ready, barbecued, grilled, and he just munches it, throws the bones away, and when he throws the bones away, that bones become another bird, the same bird, and it flies away. I can imagine some of you just looking back and going, "All right, get back here." Where are you going? He was too nice. Get back here. In Jannah, they have, according to Hadith of Tirmidhi, you have marketplaces. And these marketplaces, when they go there, the marketplaces have designer faces. You don't have no plastic surgery in Jannah, brother, sister, cosmetic, this, that. You go, you have these designer faces. These are real people inside Jannah who've got beautiful faces. And they're all in different places of the market. And you just look at them, you just desire that your face looks like that and your face changes. Your face changes. But you might get worried now, right? When I go back to my wives there, they're not going to recognize me. They go come back home and their wives come running out to them. And they say, "You look even more beautiful than what you went with, the face you went with. You look even more beautiful." They will have 70 pieces of clothes on them. Thin pieces, fabrics on them. Each one is a very delicate fabric on the Hura'in. A Hawra. 70. And through the 70, according to Hadith of Muslim, through the 70 of these beautiful fabrics on her, he sees the love she has for him pumping in her marrow bone. Forget the heart, it's in her marrow bone. Allah has created her to see nothing more than just you. Me? You. Because you, Allah will make her be. In fact, right now, you know, you're in this world right now. You know, the hadith says, Prophet ﷺ said, you know, when a person's wife says things to him, bad things, "Oh, you this, you that, you never tidy up, you do our, you know, you get it from your wives." Yes, guys, nod your heads. Say yes. Yes. Or is he only my wife? Don't worry, she's a good person. Yeah, she's a good person. Okay. She'll be listening to this one day, you know what I'm saying? She'll be getting me back at this. But I say this to her home as well. She says bad things, whatever. One of your wives said it. You know, Rasulullah said, he says, your Hura'in in Jannah are saying, "Are you? Are you? Stop saying that. He's our husband as well. Our husband as well." It's in a hadith. So sometimes I tease my wife and I tell her this. I say, "Listen, listen, take it easy. My wife's in Jannah are saying something." My wife's in Jannah are not liking it. They're not liking it. Don't say that. And she starts laughing. Right, just to make her laugh. Yeah, I really wind her up sometimes and just make her laugh, because when she gets mad at me, I just wind her up. So, you know, the women, okay, they're probably thinking, subhanAllah, what are they going to get? They are going to become the most beautiful out of all your wives in Jannah. I didn't hear subhanAllah from you guys. Oh, gosh. There's a man that came up to me and he said, "Molviji," he said in his Urdu language, he said, "Suna hai, jannat mein jayenge to idhar ki jo biwi hai udhar bhi hogi." He said, "You know, the wife I've got here, she's going to be over there in Jannah. Is that right?" I said, "Yes, that's right." "Are Molvi sahab, idhar bhi satayi usne udhar bhi jaake satayegi." "She's giving me so much trouble here, she's going to be giving me trouble over there as well." And it's not going to be like that, don't worry, she's going to be different. All right? Don't get scared, your wife's in Jannah. She's not going to tell you to look after you, this and that. She's not going to tell you off, don't worry. Yeah? And she thinks, you know, some women, they can say, "But well, it's not fair. It's not fair. You men, you know, the men get 72 minimum in a hadith. In a hadith it says, the Hura'in you get in Jannah, the minimum you get is 72. Subhanallah. That's it, bro. That's when you say subhanallah, yeah? So, my thing to the sisters is, look, if they think that they're going to be let down when they get to Jannah, of course they're not. Their hearts will change, they'll get into Jannah, they'll be happy to share They're going to think, what? What? They'll be happy to share all your other wives with you. Okay? Now, there's some people say, no, 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 that's not fair. Well, he says, it's not fair. You know all those beautiful young boys' servants that I've got? You can take any of them if you want. Because in Jannah, everything's halal, right? But they're not. They're not going to have that heart to go. They will only have their eyes for you. You, out of all your hoods, you will love her the most. Now, the other thing I was going to say is, when your family members, imagine one family member, I said to you earlier, one gets into Jannah to Adn, one gets into Ma'wa, one gets somewhere else, Firdaus or somewhere. The beautiful thing is, in the Quran it says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاتَّبَعَتْهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتُهُمْ بِإِيمَانٍ أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, those who believe, if you as one family member get into one high place of Jannah, and the rest of your family come in Jannah in different lower places, I'm going to put all of your family of the lower places with you in the highest place. Subhanallah al-Azim. Now you imagine if one of your family members gets to Firdaus, all of your family is in Firdaus, free of charge. You get bumped up. You know, when there's no space in economy, they bump you up to first class. Yeah? You get bumped up in Jannah. So that is Allah's rahmah. When you get there, the whole family is going to be in Firdaus. It's from the Quran. The whole family members will be together. But don't worry, you're going to be all separate in your separate quarters of Jannah. Each person, like I said, minimum 10 times bigger than this world. It's going to be obviously more than that. And each person will get that, but it will be close by. If you want to visit your family members, you can visit your family members anytime you want. And you can come back to your quarters with your own place. In your palaces, imagine you're in your palace and the rivers of wine are going right underneath your palace and you can see them. And they're coming out of fountains. And you can drink whenever you want. You can drink as much as you want. You can, subhanAllah says, lahmi ta'ir, when they will have the meat, they will have used up, they will have drunk. The next thing Allah says is that they will want to go and they will want to go and spend private times. Allah said, fruits I will give you. These are not haram for you. They're halal for you. Anything you find in Jannah. It's not like Adam alayhi salam who was in Jannah and he had one thing that was haram. Okay, it's not like that. He had everything inside Jannah will be absolutely halal. And when they find it, when they find all those things, they will continue one thing after another thing until... I just want to... until it comes to one great hadith, which I'm going to quote to you later on. Okay? I just want to quote a certain hadith that I've got here about Jannah. In a narration of Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be the first one who will come to the door of Jannah on the Day of Judgment. And he will knock on the door. And the gatekeeper of Jannah, who is Ridwan, he will say, who is it? And he says, I will say, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will say, I am Muhammad. He will say, Bika umirt la aftah li ahadin qablak. I have been ordered that I do not open this door for anyone before you. Our Prophet ﷺ will be the first in Jannah. The people who will come into Jannah, Prophet ﷺ says, it's a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. He says they will enter Jannah ala suratil qamari laylatul badri on the 14th night, the moon, the way it looks beautiful in the sky. Completely full of glow and natural light, and it's beautiful to look at. Their faces will be looking like that. Every person of Jannah when they walk into Jannah. He says that their combs will be made of gold. Their own sweat will be of musk. Their places where they will have... Their places inside, you know, their wives will be hurain. Now, what does hurain mean? Hurain means that they will be women with wide eyes, and the middle part, the pupil, will be very dark and black. Now, that's just the pupil inside. The woman, subhanallah al-azim, Allah has said in the Quran, He has made them similar ages. Inna ansha'nahunna insha'an faja'alnahunna abkara. They're going to be same age as you. Every person in Jannah will be the age of Isa alayhi salam when he left, which is 33. And you never grow any older. And she is exactly the same. Some people have said that there's certain narration that say the old women will be 16 and old men will be 33. That's not right. According to the Quran, all men and women will be at the same age of 33. They will be the same age. And Allah says when they will come in Jannah, they will all come in at once. Each group that comes in, they come stepping straight. Allah's Messenger said this in Hadith of Bukhari Muslim. The door of Jannah is so big, at one moment, if all the human beings, if all the jinns all wanted to step inside that door, at the same time, they'll all fit in. That's how big the door is. Can you imagine how big this place is? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I saw on the day of judgment there was a small group. I saw another he says that I saw, and this is good news for us. Okay, this is a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim from Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, many different nations were shown to me about the day of judgment. I saw one prophet with him was a small group. I saw another prophet with him, there was maybe one man or two men with him. That's it. Those are the only followers that they believed in him. I saw one prophet, there was no one with him. There will be certain prophets on the day of judgment, no one believed in the message. Then I saw a massive group of people in the horizon, and I thought, this is my ummah. And it was said to me, this is Musa alayhi salam and his ummah. These are the Jews, the good Jews. Yeah, who are they? The good Jews who believed in Musa alayhi salam. I'll see you in Jannah inshallah. And the bad Jews, you know, please don't associate yourself with us. And then he was said to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now look at the horizon. And I looked at the horizon and I saw a bigger group. And he was said to me, I thought to myself that this might be my group, but it wasn't. This must have been the group of Isa alayhi salam. He said, look again at the horizon. I saw a massive, massive group. I saw 70, from amongst them there are 70,000 who will go to Jannah without any punishment, without any reckoning. So then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got up and the people started to talk. Sahaba talked all night. They said, who are these people who will go to Jannah without any punishment, without any reckoning? You know, they were thinking, who are they? Maybe they are the people who are the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some said maybe they're the ones who were born as Muslims and they never committed shirk in their life. And they made so many different suggestions. The Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out on them to the next day and he said, what were you talking about? And they said, we were talking about who these people are. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, humul ladina la yarqun wa la yastarqun wa la yatatayyadun ala rabbihim yatawakkalun. These are the people who will not take any ruqya. Basically, they have so much dependence on God, they don't want to take any ruqya. Or it means they will only take the ruqya which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the ruqya of, the halal ruqya. They will take that, not nothing that of the jahili period, which is basically to get blown on to or have certain things done to you when you're ill. And these are the people who do not even ask anyone else for ruqya, and they do not take any omen from anything. They only depend on Allah. And Uqasha bin Mihsan, he stood up and he said, Messenger of Allah, make dua that I become from these people. And Prophet ﷺ said, you are from them. You are from them. And then another man stood up and he said, Messenger of Allah, make dua that I become. Now this man who stood up after him was a munafiq. Prophet ﷺ said, Uqasha has beaten you to it. Uqasha has, he didn't want to say to him, you are from Jahannam. How diplomatic the Prophet is. He said, Uqasha is beating you to it. Because he was a munafiq who stand up, the second man who stood up. According to another hadith, in Muslim, Mughira bin Shu'bah radiallahu anhu says, the Prophet said that Musa alayhi salam, he asked his Lord, what will be the lowest part in Jannah? So it was said, it will be a man who will come after everyone will receive Jannah. And this is the hadith that we talked about at length. Until we get to the last part, because I don't want to repeat again the words that I've said. Allah will say, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ أَرَدْتُ غَرَسْتُ كَرَامَتَهُمْ بِيَدِي. Allah will say, I have pinned down into yourselves my nobility, my generosity is inside yourselves. I have completely sealed for you things that no eye has heard, no ear has, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has ever thought. It's a hadith in Muslim. In a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, between two sides of one door in Jannah will be like Makkah and Basra. You know, Basra, which is in where? Iraq. And Makkah, where is it? He said, between two sides of one door, one of the smaller doors in Jannah will be this size. When they will come into Jannah, there will be different doors calling from different actions. There are certain doors, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is a hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, which has been reported in Bukhari and Muslim, where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there will be people who used to pray a lot, salah a lot, they will be called through the doors of salah. Just on this point, I want to mention one thing about Jahannam, which is a couple of things about Jahannam. They will be asked, ma salakakum fi saqar, what brought you into hellfire? What brought you into hellfire? They will say, qalu lam nakum min al musallin. They will say, we never used to pray our salah inside the dunya. One big reason for ending up in hellfire is that you don't do your salah, 5 times daily prayers. Another reason Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said is the one that he said, two categories of people, I haven't seen them. Sinfaini min ahli nar, lam arahum, I haven't even seen them. One of them he said is what? Kasiyat, ariyat. Women who are dressed but naked at the same time. My sister who allows brothers to see her beauty apart from her face and her hands, or some narrations her feet, but nevertheless the face and the hands. If you allow people to see your beauty, your hidden beauty, who are not your mahrams, who are not related to you, and you do that, listen to this hadith. He said they will not even smell the fragrance of Jannah. La ilaha illallah. Not even smell the fragrance of Jannah. There are women who wear clothes but they're naked at the same time. What does that mean? Parts of them are naked. Or they wear such clothes that are see-through. See-through clothes. So please warn our sisters of this. Anyway, in this hadith it says, in Jannah there will be a door for the people of jihad. They will be called towards that. There will be and please, jihad means any struggle, okay? So I'm not asking these people to go out there and to blow up Forest Gate, alright? Please, guys, have a rest. People of Saum who used to fast a lot, they will be called from the doors of fasting. People who used to give sadaqah, they will be called from the doors of sadaqah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, Messenger of Allah, these are doors that they get called from certain individuals who had certain actions. Is there anyone who will be called from all the doors? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said all 8 doors, will they get called from all 8 doors? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yes, O Abu Bakr, and you will be from one of them. He said, I have hope, you will be from one of them. You'll be from one of them. Do you want to get this station? Do you want to get this station in Jannah that all the doors of Jannah call you? Yeah. Yes. After wudu, raise your forefinger, index finger, say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Just say that much by raising your index finger to the sky after your wudu. And one hadith says, you all 8 doors of Jannah will call you on the Day of Judgment. So if you want to be of them, this is one good way of being from these people. In a separate hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Jannah will have, at least he will have in one place, 100 different stations, different stages inside Jannah. He said the place of one single whip, a place of a whip placed on this earth, that whip, if you took that whip and placed it in Jannah, that portion of it will be better than whatever the world has, the whole world, or whatever it contains. And subhanallah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given us good news of the hafiz of the Quran, the one who will memorize the Quran. But please remember carefully, there's a condition to this in a hadith of Tirmidhi. A lot of people think that if person memorizes the Quran he will get this. No. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has added a condition. He said, man ahalla halalahu wa harrama haramahu. Whoever is a hafiz of the Quran, who has memorized the Quran and regards the Quran's halal to be halal and the Quran's haram to be haram, you regarded that with your actions, then you are from these people that the first thing that you will receive on the Day of Judgment is what? You come up on the Day of Judgment and your parents are sitting on thrones and they have crowns of light on top of their heads. Subhanallah. That's your parents. What about you? You, Allah will say, come to Jannah and come to the bottom of Jannah first. And Allah will say, according to the hadith in Ahmad, Sahih hadith in Ahmad, Iqra wartaqi warattil kama kunta turattil fi dunya. You read, start reading, and start each ayah you say, you will go one level up in Jannah. And each level you go, you carry on going next ayah. So Alif Lam Mim takes in one level. Dhalika al-kitabu la rayba fi hudan lil muttaqin. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ And think, what did Allah say to him? Subhanallah, you know there's a difference between the hafiz, a lot of hafiz, right? Some people think, you know, the best hafiz is the one that can race the fastest. Drum, 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 like horses. It's not a horse race. Tarawih is not a horse race. Some people think that. They look for, you know, that masjid is 1 hour. full Taraweeh, no. That one is 45 minutes. No, another one please. That one 45 minutes, Isha, Witr, Taraweeh, 20 rakats, all inclusive, one package. I want to go to that one. And they go there and they hear the Quran like this. There's Alif Lam Mim. And the only thing you can understand is Ulaika humul muflihun. I cannot stand people who read like that. And what would Allah say here? According to the Hadith of Ahmad, he will say what? He will say what? He will say Iqra wartaqi warattil. Recite in a steady manner. Just as you used to recite in the dunya, kama kunta turattil fi dunya. Fa inna manzilatuk aw fa inna manziluk manzilak inda akhir ayatin kunta taqrauha. The last ayah, your station will be where your last ayah will take you. That means the person will recite in nice steady manner. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. Quran is beautiful when you listen to it in its proper way. And he will recite until Allah, his final destination is where? It's Jannatul Firdaus. And with him is what? With him goes who? Whole family will go with him. And on the day of judgment, Allah will give him another reward. 10 free tickets, get out of jail free cards. On the day that he can bail anyone out who's been sent to Jahannam from his family members. That's a Hafiz who has regarded the halal of the Quran as halal. In Jannah there will be different rooms, and the rooms will be on top of rooms. Allah has mentioned in the Quran, here in the Hadith it's been mentioned, one room to another room. The distance will be like from the east to the west in some places. The east to the west of this place. And the Sahaba said, Messenger of Allah, there's a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. They said, Messenger of Allah, are these the places of the Anbiya, of the Prophets? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Bala walladhi nafsi biyadi, I swear by the one who has my soul in his hand. Rijalun amanu billahi wa saddaqul mursali. These are people who believed in Allah and who just said the messengers, whatever they said is truth. They attested to what the messenger said. In Jannah there will be certain tents. This is a hadith again in Bukhari and Muslim. Certain tents. The length of this tent will be 60 miles long. One tent. لِلْمُؤْمِنِ فِيهَا أَهْلُونَ يَطُوفُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَلَا يَرَى بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا. I said, there will be so many people inside. Not some of them won't even see others. That's how great it is. There will be many pearls in Jannah, which is again a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Rasulullah said in one hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, there will be two gardens. Some people will receive two whole Jannahs. Now some people receive one Jannah, that is minimum 10 times bigger than this. Some people receive two. Who is that for? Allah said in Surah Al-Rahman, وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانِ. If you fear standing in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment, for you there's two different Jannahs. Everyone will get one, you will get two. And both of them will be minimum 10 times bigger than this world. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, two of them will be what? Min fidda. They will be from silver. Everything inside is silver. There will be other two that will be made of everything inside. It will be of gold. And subhanallah, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَمَا بَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ وَبَيْنَ أَن يَنْظُرُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ إِلَّا رِدَاءُ الْكِبْرِيَةِ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِ فِي جَنَّةِ عَدْنِ. Nothing between them and between Allah will be stopping them from seeing Allah, except for a veil that he will strike between them. They've got Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right next to them. In another hadith, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that I came into Jannah. This is a hadith in Ahmad and it's a sahih hadith. He said, when I got into Jannah, this is the night of the Mi'raj, he said, I come across this whole river. This river, the sides of it were all made of pearls. And they had tens of pearls. So I basically put my hand to the water, and when the water, that river that was flowing between these tents, and I picked up the water and it was smelling of pure musk. And I said, oh Jibreel, what is this place? And what is this water? And Jibreel said, this is the kawthar that Allah will give to you, which we will have inside Jannah. And the first place of this kawthar will be from Firdaus, and then it will go down to below, the parts below, and they will receive it. Prophet ﷺ said, one morning or one evening in the path of Allah is better than whatever the world, this world and whatever it contains. Just one word. And he said in the same hadith, this is a hadith in Bukhari, where Prophet ﷺ says, if a woman of Jannah was to just look into this world from the universe, just, and in one hadith he says, if she were to put just even a finger, then she will make the sun look dark. If she was to put her finger just inside the universe or the sky, لَأَضَاءَتْ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا, everything between the whole of the earth and the sky, in this hadith of Bukhari, Prophet ﷺ says, will be completely lit up. And it will be full of fragrance. If she just puts the part of it inside, the whole universe will be full of fragrance. That's how, you know, that's how Allah has created them. So, you know, the Sahabas, they asked, Prophet ﷺ said, this is a hadith in Tirmidhi, he said, a man in Jannah, he will be given this much power, that much power. And there's a mention of Allah, you know, they used to have a nice joke with the Prophet ﷺ. Prophet ﷺ sometimes used to joke with them. And this deen is not, you know, you can joke. Prophet ﷺ said once to a woman, she was an old woman, and she said, Messenger of Allah, will old women go into Jannah? He said, no. Messenger of Allah, will old women go into Jannah? No. Allah will make old women young and then put them into Jannah. This is they record this as a joke of the Prophet. So you know, this Sahaba is here, according to the hadith of Tirmidhi, the same Messenger of Allah. Are we going to be able to take so many women on? They said, Ya Rasulullah, awa yutiqu thalik, can a man really take that many women on? So Prophet ﷺ said, Yu'ta quwwata mi'a, you'll get the strength of 100 men. 100 men. 100 in Arabic means a lot. It doesn't mean 100. So after 100, you're like, oh man, lost my power and my energy. They sing in Jannah. This Hudayn sing in Jannah. This is a hadith in Tabrani, and this is Sahih hadith in Tabrani. What do they say? They say, we are the wives of certain people inside the dunya. From the most beautiful, he said, the best voice you can imagine, they sing that. And they sing together, they hold their hands. Your wives in Jannah, they're holding their hands. And they're dancing and they're singing, and they're saying, نَحْنُ الْخَيْرَاتُ الْحِسَانِ. They say that we are the best women. أَزْوَاجُ قَوْمٍ كِرَامٍ. We are women of a nation that is noble, that looks with most beautiful eyes. And what they say is, نَحْنُ الْخَالِدَاتِ فَلَا يَمُتْنَا. They say, we are going to be living forever, we'll never die. نَحْنُ الْآمِنَاتِ, we are those who are in complete safety, no one will ever reach us, no one, you know, we do not fear anyone. We will be here forever. And what they also, subhanAllah, what Allah has said is, He has said these women, لَمْ يَطْمِثْهُنَّ إِنْسٌ قَبْلَهُمْ وَلَا جَانٌ. You know, when a guy gets married to a wife, his wife, he gets married to a woman, one of the fears that he has is, you know, has she really all mine from day number one? Or has she basically maybe slept with another man before? Basically, is she a virgin? And Allah said in the Holy Quran, your wives in Jannah, لَمْ يَطْمِثْهُنَّ إِنْسٌ قَبْلَهُمْ وَلَا جَانٌ. When I created them, I have created them in a way that no single man, no single jinn has ever touched them. You're going to be the first person to ever touch them. First of the first. And also last, no one else is going to touch her after you. Don't worry about that. She's not going to look at you one day and say, I'm going to be bored of you, I want to change my husband. Now some women, they get a bit bored. What do you marry the guy for? He had a good face. Well, that's it. Good face goes and you stop the marriage. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's people, they're all sorts of, why you marry people and then you get bored of them? There's women that want to change their husband like they want to change their car. Man, the guy's not a car. I'm saying, he's your husband, you have to look after him. And she's, you know, some people want to change their wives. It's horrible, just because they're getting bored of looking at her. Why are you getting bored of looking at her? You're supposed to be with her till you get to Jannah, right? You keep her. Serious marriage is that you keep her until you come to the end, until death departs you. This is not an excuse to get rid of her because she's not looking beautiful anymore. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you get married to a woman for what? For her deen. Okay, now before I come to this last couple of hadith, which is the, I might as well say this hadith, and I've got just a few more things to say to you, and then we'll end the night. Hopefully by around 4:15 we should finish, okay? I'm trying to just, if you really have to go, you can go, and then you can see this later on, whatever, but allow me just to finish it, because we wanted to finish both of them today, Jannah and Jahannam. You know, in Jannah, there's going to be, you've got the marketplaces, you've got the Hurain, you've got the gifts and rivers and trees and you name it, you've got all of that. The best thing inside Jannah is what we're saying now, the hadith. Again, Bukhari and Muslim. Allah one day will say to the people of Jannah, O people of Jannah, they will say, we are here, O Allah, we are here, we are present. And all good lies in your hands. Allah will say, are you pleased? Are you pleased? They will say, why should we not be pleased, O our Lord? When you have given us things that you have not given anyone else amongst your creation before. Allah will say, shall I give you something that is better than that? They will say, Ya Rab, wa ayyu shayin afdal dhalik? O our Lord, what is better than that? Allah will say, I now proclaim, I declare that I am completely pleased with you. I will never, ever, ever become angry with you ever again. This will make him so happy inside Jannah. In one riwayat it says that they could actually die with this happiness if they had hearts of this world. Then, on another hadith, Allah says, one person, one thing will call out, Inna lakum an tasihhu fala tasqamu abada. You will be completely fine all the time in Jannah, never to get ill ever in Jannah. You will live here forever, you will never die here. You will be young here, you will never get old here in Jannah. You will be here and you will enjoy yourself and you will never be in discomfort ever. Subhanallah al-Azim. Can you imagine? You will be inside Jannah and there will never be oldness. So your grandfather, your father, your great-grandfather, your son, your great-grandson, your great-grandson, great-great-grandson, all of you same age. Hey son. Yeah dad. You're looking a bit young, you know. Dad, you're looking a bit, you know, young. Son, you're looking a bit old, you know. Same age. And you can, but you know what I said earlier, honestly speaking, you can have your private clubs in Jannah. You wanna rave in Jannah? You rave in Jannah. You know, this is one thing that you should say to yourself, I will get whatever I want in Jannah. You wanna be in Jannah and you wanna basically, you know, have a river of chocolate and you wanna drink it till you can't drink anymore, you can do that. You can go underwater into a river of wine and you can have a secret moment with her under there. Just you and just her. No one else. You wanna actually fly in Jannah, you can fly in Jannah. You wanna teleport yourself to Jannah, you can do that. Right? You wanna have, some people don't have kids in Jannah. Don't worry, women don't have to bear children in Jannah. Allah says, kun, they're born and they're given to you. You have cute little babies and the babies are cute, right? And you know what you love in this world? You know what I love? You know you have a cute little kid and you think, oh, I wish he wouldn't grow, you know, I wish he stays cute like this. Well, in Jannah, that's going to happen. Your kids, they stay, they won't bother you, don't they? They're going to scream when you're with your wife, you know what I'm saying? You have to go over there and change a nappy. There's no nappy changing in Jannah. And they stay cute as you want them. And they stay the same way, beautiful as you want them. You want in Jannah anything, Allah says, لَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَوْدُ. You want anything, you can wish for it. So people start wishing. Can you imagine what people wish? They will wish. And as they're wishing and they're wishing and they're wishing, it gets even better. Never, they ever, ever they get bored. Until one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides. He will say to them, have you received what you've received? And they will say, Allah will call the people of Jannah, O people of Jannah, are you pleased? And they will say, they are pleased. Allah will call them, you know what He will do? He will put them onto cushions. Everyone's going to get a different cushion. Each cushion inside Jannah will be higher than another one, but everyone will have their spot to see. The highest people will be the people of Firdaus, who will get the highest cushions. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, shall I give you something better than this? They will say, oh Allah, what can be better? You've whitened our faces, you've saved us from Jahannam, you've done all this for us. Allah will say, oh my angels, in the dunya, in the world, my servants, they worship me. I used to see them, they never used to see me. Today, I want to give them the chance to see me. Allah says, oh angels, you now remove the veil between me and my servants. And everyone who's in Jannah, they're all going to be in their own cushions. Like a theater. Massive one. No one will be in front of anyone. You will see directly. Sahaba said, Messenger of Allah, we are going to see Allah. Prophet ﷺ said, do you have any doubt in seeing the 14th moon night, the fourth night moon? On that 14th night, you see the moon. Do you see clearly without any clouds in the sky? They said, yes, we see it. He said, that's how you will see Allah. And in a hadith, he says, and various hadith, he says, when they will look at Allah, when inshallah bidna, we will look at Allah, inshallah. That glance at Allah, that look at Allah, Allah will be so beautiful, so magnificent. So capturing of the eyes, so beautiful just to look at him, that a person will forget the whole of Jannah and whatever it contains. The hoors, they'll forget them. Rivers, houses, palaces, families, firdaus, forgotten just by looking at Allah. And everyone will wish that they get the longest time to look at Allah. And in one hadith, he says, every Friday Allah will do this. He'll give the chance. Some people, they will get to look at Allah for very, very long times, very, very long periods. Now, the final thing that I want to share with you is, there's just a few hadith here of how to get to Jannah. Prophet ﷺ said, these certain things, whoever will do them, they will be in Jannah. Okay? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith of Bukhari, "Man laqiya Allah la yushriku bihi shay'an dakhala al-jannah." Whoever will meet Allah, they do not assign any partners with him, they will be in Jannah. And what some of these hadith mean is, if you have a punishment period, it could come somewhere in between. Dakhala al-jannah means one day eventually you will enter Jannah. You will enter. It could mean that you go straight into Jannah. It could mean that, but it could also mean that you might have a period where you have to go through something else. In Bukhari, Prophet Sallallahu says that those people who have believed, they have believed in Allah and His Messenger, they have done their 5 daily prayers, they have fasted Ramadan, it is Allah's moral duty to enter them into Jannah. In a hadith of Bukhari, Prophet Sallallahu says, whosoever will build a house, a masjid here in the world for Allah, Allah will build them a palace for them in Jannah. And that means also any contributions you give to the masjid, if you have a share in that, Allah will give you a share in a big palace in Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith of Bukhari, whosoever prays the two cold prayers, they will go straight into Jannah. Dakhala al-Jannah, they've gone to the Jannah. What are these two prayers? These two prayers are the morning Fajr and the nighttime Isha. And some have said Fajr and Asr. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith of Bukhari, whosoever spends his morning in the path of Allah and spends his evening in the path of Allah, spends his morning going towards the masjid, spends his evening going towards the masjid, every time he goes there, Allah will create for him a good place in Jannah. In a hadith of Bukhari, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whosoever will guarantee for me that which is between your two jawbones, and that is between your two thighs, which is that, your tongue and your private part. You guarantee me that you will protect these two things, I guarantee for you Jannah. This is from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. In a hadith according to Muslim, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, whosoever will take a pathway towards Jannah, that they will try and seek Jannah, they will try and seek knowledge, Allah will make the pathway to Jannah easy for them. In a hadith of Abu Dawud, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, whosoever will repeat after what the Muaddin has said, when the Muaddin says Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and you say straight after that from your heart, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, you say, yes, I witness that Allah is only one, Allah is only one. You do that after the Muaddin, you repeat as the Muaddin, you have gone straight into Jannah. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to hadith of Abu Dawud, he says, none of you does a wudu and he performs a very beautiful wudu, a good wudu, and he prays two rakats only, thinking of nothing inside those two rakats. From the beginning to the end, with his heart, with his face turning towards Allah, he thinks of nothing but Allah, except Jannah has become wajib on you. Jannah is wajib. Now, if you, this is simple, brothers, this is simple. You pray two rakats, nice wudu, just as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has done it. And a nice two rakats. Try and do this. Has anyone achieved that, doing two rakats, where if from Allahu Akbar to Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you've thought nothing except for Allah? Have you ever done that? Come put your hands up. If you haven't, just do it. Do it by tonight. Yeah, don't wait for tomorrow. You might wake up dead. But don't worry, you'll wake up in Jannah. Inshallah. Whosoever will say this, now say this with me. Raditu billahi rabba. I am pleased for Allah to be my Lord. Wabil Islami Deena, I am pleased for Islam to be my religion. Wabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Nabiya, I am pleased for Muhammad to be my prophet. Whoever says that, Jannah is wajib on you. Jannah is incumbent on you. There are certain simple things that inshallah bi'idhnillah Jannah will become easy for you. In Abu Dawud it says, whosoever's last statement from them will be La ilaha illallah, they will go into Jannah. In Tirmidhi the hadith, whosoever will say Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdi, one date palm will be created for them in Jannah. In Tirmidhi it says, whosoever dies and they are free from three things, they are free from arrogance, they are free from cheating, and they are free from debts, they will go straight to Jannah. In a hadith in Tirmidhi, it says, whosoever will look after two girls, I will enter Jannah and him together into Jannah. One time he said, whosoever has three girls. You know, some people say I have girls, they don't have boys. Subhanallah, Allah is giving you your ticket to Jannah inside your own house. He said, whosoever will have three girls and will look after them, will give them good ta'dib, good akhlaq, good character, will nurture them well, and give them a good Islam, good upbringing, they will, Allah will give them in return of that, He will give them Jannah. One person stood up and said, Messenger of Allah, what about me? I've got two daughters. He said, even two daughters. Another person said, Messenger of Allah, I've only got one daughter. He said, even one daughter, good tarbiyah, good nurturing and good Islam, you bring them up with that, you have brought your ticket to Jannah. And you know another thing to Jannah is, Subhanallah, another way to Jannah is, if you have a baby and your child dies before the age of puberty, it's very hard for the parents here. Either it dies as a fetus in the womb of the mother, there's a miscarriage, or it dies after coming to this world at any moment before they reach the age of like 10, 11, 12, or the age of puberty. If you have sabr over that, if you have patience over that, on the day of judgment, there will be a time when Allah will release all the children who died under puberty, because they're all going to Jannah. But before they go to Jannah, they will say, oh Allah, release us on the day of judgment. We want to go and look for our parents. Without our parents, we're not going to Jannah. You know anyone who has their child who's died young, tell them this hadith, where the children will actually take them straight to Jannah with them. And without that, they will not be happy unless they take them. Say this with me. Allahumma adkhilni al-Jannah. Say it three times. Whosoever will say that, oh Allah, put me into Jannah. Oh Allah, put me into Jannah. Oh Allah, put me into Jannah. Whosoever will ask that three times, Jannah will say, oh Allah, Jannah is saying this right now. We've said it, right? Jannah says, oh Allah, enter him into me. Oh Allah, enter him into me. Oh Allah, enter him into me. This is hadith in Tirmidhi. And Subhanallah, the hadith in Tirmidhi says, whosoever will visit a sick person or a brother of his, an angel will cry out that you have done something good, you walk in a good place, and you have now created your station in Jannah. In Bukhari, there's a hadith that says, you start to speak the truth will lead you to good virtue, the virtue will lead you to Jannah. And the opposite is said in that hadith, that if you speak lies, lies will lead you to sins, and sins will lead you to hellfire. Whosoever, in a hadith, it says, whosoever will do a umrah and then perform another umrah between the two things, and whosoever will do one umrah and then another umrah, or whosoever will do a hajj that is mabrur. Hajj means such a hajj, mabrur. What is mabrur hajj? Means that when you come back from hajj, your life changes for good. You don't go back to your bad ways, and your life changes for the better. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no other reward for you except for Jannah. Except Allah will give you Jannah. Whosoever will memorize the 99 names of Allah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam quoted hadith of Bukhari. He said, according to hadith of Bukhari, whoever will memorize them, they will enter Jannah. You know who Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar, and so on. Whoever memorized that. In Muslim, there is a hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I saw a man who got into Jannah. He was in Jannah, he was lying down. He was enjoying his moment in Jannah, lying down. And you know when you turn in your sleep, and oh, you enjoy that turn, yeah? He said, I saw a man who got into Jannah. And the reason why he got into that is because he saw a branch of a tree that was stuck in the pathway of people. People had to duck down to get across the branch. He decided one day, why should people duck down? He just cut the branch, and because of that, he went straight into Jannah. This hadith I've said to you before, and I'm repeating again, you know that I hope, inshallah, a lot of you are reading this. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa anta khalaqtani wa ana abduk wa ana ala ahdik wa wa'dika mastata'tu a'udhu bika min sharri ma sana'tu abu'u laka bi ni'matika alayya wa abu'u bi dhanbi faghfirli fa innahu la yaghfiru dhunuba illa anta. In one of my previous ones I've said this. Whosoever will say this after Fajr, if you die before Maghrib, and if you say it after Maghrib and you die before Fajr, then you go straight into Jannah. If you say it from the heart, you go straight into Jannah. Okay, the last thing I will say to you, brothers, before we go, is Allah said in the Holy Quran, "Ya ibadi al-ladina asrafu ala anfusihim la taqnatu min rahmatillah." O my servants who have wasted your lives, never become hopeless of my mercy. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a. Allah can forgive all sins all at one go. Innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim, he's the oft-forgiving, he's the oft-merciful one. Wa anibu ila rabbikum, and start being inclined toward your Lord. Wa aslimu lahu, and submit to him. Qabla an ya'tiyakum al-adhab, before a punishment comes to you. Baghtatan, all of a sudden. Wa antum la tashuruna, you will not even know how it came to you. And turn to me before a time comes when punishment arrives. And when punishment arrives, you start to have regrets. What you regret? Your regret is أن تقول نفس يا حسرتا على ما فرطت في جنب الله. Oh my, what have I done to myself? What are the things that I start lacking in terms of the duties I had towards Allah? Why did I do that? أن تقول نفس يا حسرتا على ما فرطت في جنب الله. وإن كنت لمن الساخرين. I am the one who used to really not take this serious. أو تقول نفس when it's, or maybe one of you will come on the day of judgment, you'll see the punishment and you'll wish that you want to go back. حِينَ تَرَى الْعَذَابَ لَوْ أَنَّ لِي كَرَّةً. If only I had one more chance to go back, I will go back. Or you will say this, but it will be too late. So before that time comes late, Allah has said, turn towards me. And the final hadith I will say. And this is a beautiful hadith. Okay, beautiful hadith of the Prophet. So this is the last hadith, and I tell you, you can go home after this, yeah? You've heard enough of Jannah and Jahannam today. This is the hadith in Muslim. And there's a similar hadith in Bukhari as well. أنا عند ظني عبدي بي وأنا معه حيث يذكرني أو إذا ذكرني. I am with my servant as he thinks me to be. I will deal with my servant as he thinks to me. And I am with him when he remembers me. When he remembers me in his self, I will remember him in my exalted being. I want you to just remember Allah. Just remember Allah now. Allah has remembered you. When he will remember me in a gathering, say Allah. Allah. Ya Allah. Allah. We remember him in a gathering. Allah says, I remember him in a gathering better than that which is the gathering of the angels. When we say Ya Allah, Allah has just said Ya Sadiq, Ya Shafiq, Ya Muhammad, Ya this. Allah has just said that. Say Ya Allah again.
Ya Allah.
When you said that, Allah has just taken your name. How can a person move away from the deen? Brothers, you know the people who are not practicing Islam, go and tell them this hadith. You come to Allah, you remember Him, Allah will remember you. Whoever comes towards me one single span length, I will come to him a whole arm's length. Whoever comes to me one arm's length towards me, I will come to him two arm's lengths. Whoever walks towards me, I will run towards him. The hadith of Bukhari and of Muslim. This means Allah's mercy will run towards us. Bi-idhnillah, inshallah, we'll do our best to do all the things we can to save ourselves, inshallah, from Jahannam. All the things we can to gain Jannah, inshallah. Right? We'll have a dua now. صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلاة تنجينا بها من جميع الأهوال والآفات وتقضي لنا بها جميع الحاجات وتطهرنا بها من جميع السيئات وترفعنا بها أعلى الدرجات وتبلغنا بها أقصى الغايات من جميع الخيرات في الحياة وبعد الممات اللهم يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا سميع يا بصير يا حنان يا منان يا حنان يا منان يا حنان يا منان يا الله يا مبين يا حي يا قيوم نسألك يا ربنا ويا سيدنا ويا غاية رغبتنا يا إلهي ويا خالقي ويا مالكي ويا ربي ويا سيدي يا رب العرش العظيم ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار والله يا الله نعوذ بك من فتنة المسيح الدجال نعوذ بك من فتنة القبر وعذاب القبر نعوذ بك من فتنة يوم القيامة نخاف أن نقوم أمامك يوم القيامة دستر كوكورينو دستر دواري لاتي دندا مريا نتراو أمراري তাড়াইলে ফিরে আইমু কুত্তা যে তোমার দয়ার আল্লাহ দয়া করো দুহাই তোমার Balataki burataki tabuho tuma. Balataki burataki tabuho tuma. Kuta zaimu firya aimu guria guria. Tumi bine ke bujibe amar bedon. Tumi sara kar kase korimurudon. O Allah, O merciful one, O one who knows the secrets of the beings that He has created. O one who knows every single action that I have done in my life. O one who knows at this moment what will happen to me at the time of my death. O one who knows and who has decreed for me my place in the next life. O Allah, O Mawla, we make your angels a witness at this moment, we make you a witness. O Allah, we haven't seen you, but we yearn to see you, Mawla. O Allah, we yearn to see you and we make you a witness that we have no other belief except that we believe in La ilaha illallah. O Allah, we believe that you are one Mawla, you are one Mawla. O Allah, we have no one else except for you. You have said in the Holy Quran, وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Who else is there to forgive sins except for you? O Allah, here we are as masakeen, as beggars at your door. We have come to your door. When your enemies go away from your door, they go full-handed. How is it that your believing servants who have come to you will go empty-handed from your door, Mawla? We have hope that you will not send us empty-handed today. Mawla, we bought for you certain gifts, and when we looked into our treasures, when we looked into the actions that we have done for you, we have only seen sins. Oh Allah, there is not a single deed that we can find for yourself that has been done purely for yourself. Oh Allah, how many times in our lives that we have taken your gifts and we have taken advantage of your gifts and we have only become strengthful in disobeying you again. How many times have you let us off and how many times have you forgiven us and how many times have you not made us blind because of the sins that we have committed with our eyes? How many times have you decided not to make us deaf because of the sins that we have committed with our ears? How many times have you decided that you will not give us ill health because of the sins that we carry on our bodies? Mawla, we are diseased, Mawla, with the sins that we have committed. And the only one that we know to come to you is Ya Ahada Man La Ahada La Wa Ya Sanada Man La Sanada La. Oh Allah, you are the one for the one who has no one else. You are the support for the one who has no other support. You are the one who turns darkness into light. You are the one who raises. And you are the one who can turn a sinner into a good person over one moment. Oh Allah, we are beggars at your door. Take our sins away, Mawla. We are ashamed to bring these sins to your door, to your house, Mawla. Mawla, these people have sat here for hours listening to this, Mawla. Forgive me, forgive them. Oh Allah, take our sins away from us, and Mawla, change the sins and give us good reward instead. Oh Allah, change them and give them back to us as good reward so that we can carry them back. Oh Mawla, oh Mawla, oh Master, we have nowhere else to go. If we die in this state, then Mawla, we do not know what will happen to us. Mawla, when the time comes, and the time comes for us to taste death, Mawla, we ask you to give us good news of rawhun wa rayhan. Fabashirna bi rawhin wa rayhanin wa rabbin ghayri ghabban. Oh Allah, give us good news that you are not angry with us at that time. Oh Allah, take us in the best of our moments, in the best of our days, when we are in sujood for your sake, when we are in your sabirillah, when we are in your pathway, Mawla. Raise us on the day of judgment with the best of our actions. Oh Allah, we make a sincere tawbah right now in case we die after this moment. Mawla, we ask you, Mawla, to send 500 angels from Jannah. Oh Allah, carrying Mawla the sense of Jannah. And oh Allah, let them embrace us, Mawla. Oh Allah, let us look at our family members and tell them, don't cry for me at this moment. Wash me quickly, send me to my house quickly. Oh Allah, let us be of those who want to go to the grave quickly. Oh Allah, make the grave a place that we want to go to. Make it one of the gardens of paradise. Oh Allah, Mawla, let not 500 angels come from Jahannam, beating us and beating our souls out of our bodies. Mawla, we make tawbah to you today. We return back to you. Oh Allah, we seek refuge in you from the azab and punishment you have created. Oh Allah, we ask you in our graves, you widen our graves and you make us say the three questions, we answer them properly. Oh Allah, we ask you, Mawla, that you make us be from the people of Illiyin. And Mawla, with us all our people who have passed away from our family members before. Mawla, if one of our parents is alive at this moment, then we ask you, oh, both of my life, oh Allah, give them a long, nice, healthy, pious life. Let them not be a burden on anyone else. Oh Allah, let not any old people, any old person here be a burden on anyone else. But Mawla, if one of our parents or both of our parents have gone away from this world, then Mawla, they are at your mercy, they are in your hands. رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Oh Allah, have mercy on them wherever they are. Put them with the people of Illiyin and with them and all of us here when we raise our heads on the Day of Judgment. Mawla, make our arms, make our faces shine with the places of wudu that we have done. Oh Allah, let it be with light that our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recognizes us amongst a sea of black people, that he tells the angels to come and grab us, to fetch us from the sea of black people. Mawla, we want to be next to a Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, send salutations on the one who will intercede for the people on the Day of Judgment. Send salutations on the one who lost his two teeth in the Battle of Uhud. Send salutations on the one who was stoned in the Battle of Taif. Oh Allah, send salutations on the one who came to this world and who only grieved for his ummah. Send salutations on the one who will be first to enter Jannah. Send salutations on the one who will be pleased to see his ummah and make us from his close ummah. Oh Allah, give us the best of character so that we may be next to him on the Day of Judgment. Mawla, let us drink kawthar from his hands. Let us be from the makers from the 70,000 that will go to Jannah without any reckoning, without any punishment. Oh Allah, the day when we will stand in front of you, you will call us one by one. Mawla, we have no way of giving you any answer. Honest to Allah, we are being honest with yourself. If you ask us, why did we do this? We have no answer. Mawla, Mawla, show us your mercy, show us your generosity, Mawla. You are Arhamur Rahimin. Mawla, you are the most merciful of those who have mercy, most generous of those who have generosity, O Allah. Cast a veil around us if you ever ask us anything on the Day of Judgment. Do not disgrace us in front of the people who knew us on this world. Oh Allah, those of us, including myself, who have knowledge, who have not been able to practice their knowledge, Mawla, do not embrace us on the day, do not embarrass us on the Day of Judgment. Oh Allah, we ask you, Mawla, that you give us an easy account on the Day of Judgment with our parents, with our family members, with those people who are close to us, Mawla. You give us and you take us with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam straight to Jannah. Oh Allah, we seek refuge from the snakes of Jahannam, from the scorpions of Jahannam, from the hooks of Jahannam, from the smoke of Jahannam, from the path of Jahannam, that Jahannam is seeking refuge from itself. Oh Allah, oh Mawla, if you decide to punish us, Mawla, you will not gain anything. And if you decide to forgive us, you will not lose anything. So give us that thing, Mawla, that you will not have any loss in. You will not need any gain in, Mawla. It is only our gain that you forgive us. Mawla, we ask you to make us from the first people who will go into Jannah. Oh Allah, we ask you to give us Jannatul Firdaus. Oh Allah, give us Jannatul Firdaus. Oh Allah, give us Jannatul Firdaus. Oh Allah, give us the station next to the prophets. Oh Allah, let us meet Mawla from the Day of Judgment. Let us put our next to the necks of Musa alayhi salam, next to Ibrahim alayhi salam, next to Isa alayhi salam, next to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, those of us that haven't seen him in our dreams, and even if you have seen him in our dreams, Mawla, we ask you to make us see him in our dreams again and again. Oh Allah, let us see him in our dreams, and we send salutations on him. Sallallahu ala sayyidina wa mawlana Muhammad. صلى الله على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. sahbihi wa sallam. Oh Allah, we ask you, Mawla, those of us who have got a difficulty in their life, remove our difficulty. Those of us who have got deaths, Mawla, relieve us from our deaths. Those of us who have pain in our bodies, oh Allah, relieve us from the pains in our bodies. Those of us, Mawla, who have got family members who are ill, including our brother here who is in Alim class and his father is ill, oh Allah, give him full cure, give him full shifa. And oh Allah, let him come back to his family members as he was before, nice and healthy. Oh Allah, those of us who have got a need and a desire in our hearts, Mawla, you know better about our desires. Mawla, we ask you if it is halal for us and if you are pleased with it, and grant it to us, Mawla. Oh Allah, before we die, make us your awliya and make us your close ones. Accept us in your path, oh Mawla. Give us ilm and knowledge that is beneficial. Make us do actions that you are going to accept. Oh Allah, give us provisions that are halal and make us from the most closest people to you in Jannah once people get to see you. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد.